ladies and gentlemen, Garry Moore.
Thank you.
Hello, Bill Engel.
Hi, friends. Thanks for coming.
You know, there is no spy in the whole world of literature who is more famous than James Bond. And it may surprise a lot of you to know that there is a spy in real life, a real spy, who was the prototype for James Bond. We have that super spy with us, and we will meet him and learn about him as soon as we meet our super panel here on To Tell the Truth. Bill Cullen. Peggy. Carlisle. Are you folks like me? Are you a sucker for James Bond?
Oh, 07?
Do I love
yes.
that stuff.
And all that? Oh, boy, I eat that up. And as I told the audience, there was a real life one. There is a real life one. Let's meet the real life James Bond.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Dushko Popov.
Number two.
My name is Dushko Popov.
Number three.
My name is Dushko Popov.
And here is the spy story of Dushko Popov. It says, I, Dushko Popov, served as a spy during World War II. In my book, which is called Spy Counter Spy, I tell how I acted as a double agent, passing misinformation to the Nazis while gathering accurate facts to give to British intelligence. Since Germany was paying the bills, I lived an elegant and luxurious life in those dangerous years, traveling back and forth between England and the continent. I even made a trip to the U.S., where I gave evidence to J. Edgar Hoover on the soon-to-occur Pearl Harbor bombing, but my warning was ignored. I participated in some of the most elaborate counter-espionage schemes of the war. Three of those years were later turned into movies. In addition, one evening at a gambling casino, my actions at the chemin de fer tables were utilized by Ian Fleming in his James Bond mystery, Casino Royale. However, I was not known as Secret Agent 007. My real code name was much less romantic. British intelligence called me Tricycle. Signed, Dushko Popov. And we can't start the questioning quite yet because my magic electronic decoder watch tells me it's time for, let me see, Mickey's big hand is on the 12, and yeah, it's time for a commercial. We'll be right back. Now, as I'm quite certain you recall, all three of the gentlemen sitting across the way claim to be Dushko Popov, who claims to be the prototype for super spy James Bond. And Kitty Carlisle, you said you dug James Bond, so
yes,
we'll start with
thank
you.
Thank you. Number two, why didn't Mr. Hoover believe you when you tried to announce the advent of Pearl Harbor?
Mr. Hoover did not believe me.
Why didn't he?
Because he did not trust anybody who is not an American.
Number three, what did you do at the Casino Royale that attracted Ian Fleming's attention?
I played $50,000 on a chemin de fer table.
Of your own money?
No. It was intelligent.
What were you doing it for?
I don't know, just for a...
For fun?
For the mood.
Number two, do you know who Sir William Wiseman was?
No, I don't.
Do you know number one?
No, I'm sorry.
Number three, why did you have such a poor title, like Tricycle?
Probably because I was a very poor chap.
Number two, was there another reason?
Well, Tricycle is a triumvirate of three people
yeah.
who were in my sub-network.
What?
In my sub-network.
Uh-huh. In his sub-network.
Oh, I see.
All righty, and that takes us down to Bill Cullen.
Number one, did you also play $50,000 on chemin de fer?
Yes.
Was it your money, number one?
No.
Did you win?
It wasn't the point. It was just the point of putting it down to bluff somebody.
And whose money was it, number one? I was curious about that because
I don't want to talk about this even now. Not mine.
That's been...
Actually, it was the Germans paid for it, like everything else.
I'm going to say, like, interest on that alone, since you used it, would be worth a fortune. Number two is, did you spies during your time... I guess it's all right to call you a spy, because you said that yourself.
Sure.
Did you have that romantic thing with the ladies, always beautiful girls everywhere you went, and great stuff like that there, number two?
Sure.
Yeah?
Sure.
You did, huh? Number two, are
suddenly
you...
we got a whole new spot going here. Go.
Well, were you a married man, number two, when you were spying around?
No, I was not.
Are you married now?
Yes.
You're out of the game now, huh? Yes. The spy racket, I mean.
Right.
Number one, when you were spying around and hobnobbing with those beautiful ladies, were you a married man?
No, sir.
Are you now?
Yes, sir.
That's the craziest way to retire I ever heard of in my life.
All right, from Bill Cullen, we go to Peggy.
Number three, in the Chemin de Fer game, were you going against the bank or were you holding the bank?
No, I was going against the bank.
Thank you. Number one, what's a shoe that in Chemin de Fer?
That is that little gadget where the money is coming in.
Thank you. Number two, what's the highest number to win with in Chemin de Fer?
Nine.
Thank you. Number three, where was Five Fingers stationed?
Where was what?
Five Fingers. He was a spy. You were tricycle. We had Five Fingers, too, on the other side.
No, you didn't.
Oh, we did, too. It was in a movie. Couldn't it? I saw that movie. Number two, how did you freely move from occupied, from Germany, for instance, off to occupied France to England? What kind of a passport did you use during the war?
I was stationed in England and worked in Lisbon.
Oh, you worked
in
Lisbon.
I could meet both parties.
Oh, how nice for you. Number one, do you put pepper in your vodka?
No, I didn't.
Number three, did you? Because James Bond did.
I drank whiskey, mainly.
Oh, yes, it's much more fashionable.
That's how James Bond lost the training wheels on his tricycle. Let's go down on Alda, please.
Boy, this is terrific. I think they're all good spies. Number one, why don't you want to talk about... I mean, you don't have to say who gave you the money, but why don't you want to talk about who gave you the money?
It's embarrassing. It was German money, actually.
I see. But wasn't your job, number one, wasn't your job to get money from them and lie to them and...
Yes, I did.
Yeah. Okay, number two, who paid for your trip to Washington when you went?
The British government, MI6.
I see. Number three, do you have to be a good liar to be a spy and a counter-spy?
I trust, yes.
You trust? Do you have to trust anybody? How do you know who to trust?
Myself.
I like this spot.
Hey, I want to tell you, this is a tough decision. I'm glad I don't have to vote. What do you think there at home? Is it number one? Or is it number two? Or is it number three? We pay $50 for each wrong vote. We pay $500 to the group if nobody can find the real Dushkov Popov. And Kitty starts, please.
Oh, it's very difficult. They could all be marvelous spies. I kind of went for number one. He's got a shifty look.
All right, we got to vote for number one. And number two, sir, what is your real name, please?
Hey, wait a minute. Whoa, hold it there. Wait a minute. Wait just a minute. Wait just
I'm
a
way
second
a, way
there.
Way ahead of myself. Kitty, I'll get back to why I got off later, but Bill?
Well, now, I've studied spies since old days of World War I. Bill Boyd and his flying aces, and I got a good question. I voted happily for number three is the fellow I voted for.
There's nothing on
you voted for...
Huh?
It's blank.
You got blank on there.
Crazy?
That's that crazy disappearing ink I got from years ago. Oh, I voted for three there. That's true.
Oh, crazy Cullen. All right, so we got a three show. Let's go to Peggy.
He hooks me in every time. Okay, now, number one, the money doesn't come out of the shoe. The cards come out of the shoe. And number three, Five Fingers was played by James Mason. He was a famous spy in Constantinople or Lisbon, one of those places. I voted for two because number nine is the highest number you can get.
I said it was a good team. Everybody's got one vote. Alan Alda, the majority vote lies with you.
And I have a totally irrational reason. He just looks like it to me. He looked like he was a good liar and he had the look about him of somebody who could be a spy. I voted for number three.
He's not very serious.
Voted for number three. All right. At this point, the votes are all in. Will the real Dushko Popov please stand up? Yeah. Good team over there. What threw me off earlier on, Kitty, you were talking about number one, and you said that he had a shifty look in his eye. Yeah. And I was thinking to myself, what a nice fellow, because I was shaking hands with him, and I think it couldn't have been more than a...
I give after.
Number one, what is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Ernst Hartmann. I'm a vice president of Frames Tours Limited.
So he knows about you. Good to have you with us too, sir. What is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Alfred Weiss. I'm a management systems designer, temporarily unemployed.
Mr. Popoff, is it safe for a spy to retire and then say, I have been a spy? Have you no fear of retaliation from anyone at this point?
It's a very comfortable job to retire.
It's a comfortable job to retire, yes. Yeah. Well, thank you very much. And thank you, gentlemen, also for being with us on the television. Now, next we're going to meet a man who at one time was one of the biggest men in this country. And I don't think you're going to recognize him. Stick around. Now then, before we cut out for commercial time, I told you I was going to introduce a man who used to be one of the biggest men in this country. By way of illustration, I will show you what used to be a pair of his trousers.
Holy moly. Oh.
Wow-wee.
Size 66. Can you believe it? Size 66. They belong to a gentleman by the name of Paul Kimmelman, who we will meet, and he has changed a little bit. I don't think that you will recognize him. I certainly wouldn't. Let us meet Paul Kimmelman right now.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Paul Kimmelman.
Number two.
My name is Paul Kimmelman.
Number three.
My name is Paul Kimmelman.
Son of a gun, if I think it's any one of the three of them. You know, that seems impossible.
Unbelievable.
Now, all you folks out there who say you can't lose weight because of genetic reasons or whatever, listen to this story. I, Paul Kimmelman, hold the world's record for the greatest weight loss in the shortest elapsed time. As authenticated in the Guinness Book of Records, I lost 357 pounds in 7 months. Here's my up-and-down story. Until the age of 9, I was thin. Then my adenoids were removed. Now, able to taste food, my weight went up, up, up. In the next 3 years, I went from a lean 98 to an improbable 300 pounds. And when I reached 19, I weighed 487 pounds. One day, I experienced severe stomach pains, but I was too fat to x-ray. Doctors told me that unless I lost weight, I would certainly die. I went on a crash diet and the pounds poured off. In 1 month alone, I lost 100 pounds. I had to buy new underwear every week. Finally, from a high of 487 pounds, I plummeted to an unbelievable 130. Now, however, leading a normal and healthy life, I am at the weight level where I belong, a solid 170 pounds. Signed, Paul Kimmelman. And I think we will start this with a nice, tall, and slender Alan Alda.
Thank you. Number two, do you feel that when you had the power to taste food again, that it was something like somebody coming out of a concentration camp who suddenly had food that he or she was deprived of until then? Was that the effect?
At the point when I reached my lowest weight, yes.
Yeah. I mean when you started gaining weight.
At the beginning? Well, I was 9 at the time.
Yeah. And that was because you'd lost your adenoids, huh? Well, I'm too confused by that entire exchange we just had. Number three, what did it mean that you were too heavy to be x-rayed? Couldn't the x-rays get through your body? They just stop at your liver or something?
For two reasons. One, I would not fit on the x-ray machine. And two, it would not penetrate through the fatty layers to give you a picture, yes.
It actually wouldn't get... I see.
Yes.
Maybe it was your lead drawers, I don't know. number one, how can you possibly lose 100 pounds in a month? That seems like an awful lot.
I don't know. I just
went on a diet, and that's what happened.
What kind of a diet was it, number one?
Grapefruit juice and milk.
Doctors do? Let's go down. Let's go to Kitty.
Well, number two, the doctor said you would die. Why did he think you would die if you didn't lose weight? He couldn't x-ray you. He didn't know what was the matter with you.
No, he felt that the weight I was carrying on the body was too much for the heart.
Number three, when they were able to x-ray you, what was wrong with you?
They were unable to.
But, I mean, didn't they ever find out why you had these terrible tummy aches?
Well, because of the overweight problems and the problems complicated by that, of course.
Oh, I see. Yes. Number one, it says here that you lost 100 pounds in a month. How long did it take you to get rid of the rest of it?
About six months.
And number two, when you began to get so fat and you were a little boy, what did your mother say?
She ate along with me.
Why?
Well, I didn't have a father at the time, and I think it was just a relationship.
And did she get fat, too?
She didn't gain as much as I did, but I would say about 100 pounds overweight.
And number three, did she get thin when you got thin?
Yes.
Oh, that's
she
very
lost
nice.
100 pounds.
That's good. And number one, did she get very cross when she was dieting like that?
No, she just let me do what I wanted. She did what she wanted.
What an ideal mother.
And that takes us, please, down to Bill Cullen.
Well, number three, now that you're down to a reasonably normal 170 pounds or something like that, do you still have a weight problem?
No more than the normal person now. In other words, it fluctuates a bit, but it's no problem now.
And number two, I notice all three of you gentlemen, I mean, none of you look like you were at one time heavy, like none of you have the wrinkles that are sometimes left when a lot of weight is lost. So number two, I'll ask you, did you also go on a program of exercising to tone up that tissue, to keep it from sagging, as it were?
The only exercise I did was running.
And number one, how about you, in order to keep yourself looking as you do now?
Exercise running afterwards.
Just ran?
After
you had lost the weight. Okay, now I think this is number three. I'm going to ask you the same question. How do you get such smooth features if you lost all that weight?
Well, it may surprise you, I was not under doctor's supervision. And it also has to do with heredity factors.
And I think Peggy just gave me an answer, too. She said they're young, and I guess that is the difference between my problem. Number two, how many calories a day did you take in when you first went on a diet?
When I first went on a diet?
Yes.
Between 300 and 600.
And before, I'll stay with you, before you went on the diet, how many calories did they measure you to take, or did you guess?
I was averaging before I went on a diet?
Yes, sir.
Between 20,000 and 30,000 a day.
Holy Toledo!
What is he eating?
All right, you made a buzzer. Let's go to Peggy Cass, please.
You must have been living on candy, too, were you?
No, I was not.
Okay, now number three, because you didn't give me the same diet. Is grapefruit juice and milk really all you ate?
Well, believe it or not, yes, and occasionally a salad with dressing.
But now, how much grapefruit juice and milk did you allow yourself a day?
Well, it varied. In other words, it varied.
Well, now, number two, were you able to work when you were that fat, when you were at your top weight?
I was a student at the time.
Did you finish school?
No, I dropped out.
And number one, are you employed now?
No, I'm in school.
Oh, I see. I told you they were young. Number three, why on earth did you ever get down to 130? That seems like too thin.
Well, you got to make these questions faster. I'm getting hungry.
Alrighty, the lunch bell just went, and that means that we're going to mark our ballots, and we're going to mark them for number one.
Had his joke.
Or for number two, or for number three. Not an easy choice, I don't think, but we'll find out. Alan, got an idea?
Yes. Well, the only one over there who looks to me as though he actually weighs 170 now is number two. So, and that's one of the reasons I had for voting for him. I had a lot of other reasons, but I won't go into them now.
All righty, so we got a two. And Kitty?
Well, I voted for number two because he's the only one tall enough to carry a 487 pounds, it seems to me.
Okay, Bill Cullen, please.
Well, now, when Garry held those pants up like that, I figure which one of these three guys would be able to put on those pants and fill them out and pull them up a little bit from the end and be the right height. And it came up a two, a fat two, but a two.
Well, everything is bunching up in the middle there, and from there we go to Peggy Cass.
Well, number two is very cheerful looking, and he's got big dimples. Chubby people are inclined to have big dimples, and he's so cheerful, because I'd be cheerful, too, if I lost 457 pounds.
You wouldn't even be here.
You wouldn't be here.
You lost 400. That many pounds, we'd lose four of you there. Anyhow, everybody is unanimous. We're all on number two, and so the votes are in. Will the real Paul Kilman please stand up?
Yeah!
You may have lost over 300 pounds, but you picked up 500 bucks right now for stumping the panel completely. And let's find out who you all are. Number two, what is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Peter Catalano. I'm one half the team of Peter and Peggy of PC Designs. We design jewelry for the fashion industry.
Fine. And hungry number three, what is your real name? What do you do?
My name is Ray Broussard, and I teach film at New York University and a freelance filmmaker.
Paul Kimmelman, for all the fun we've had, I know it wasn't easy. You have our congratulations. Thank you, and thank you, gentlemen, both, for being with us on To Tell the Truth. We have only 10 seconds left. There's nothing I can tell you. Thanks very much for being with us. We are fond of you. We hope the feeling is returned. Take care.
Our central characters today will receive a ring featuring a Lindy star, available in 14 colors. Lindy stars reflect the light with a magical moving six-rayed star. Promotional consideration provided by Best Western Motels, the nation's largest chain of 1,255 owner-operated motels in 900 cities throughout the United States, Canada, and Mexico. This is Bill Wendell speaking for it, To Tell the Truth. A Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production.
The British government, MI6.
I see. Number three, do you have to be a good liar to be a spy and a counter-spy?
I trust, yes.
You trust? Do you have to trust anybody? What? Who? How do you know who to trust?
Myself.
I like this spot.
Hey, I want to tell you, this is a tough decision. I'm glad I don't have to vote. What do you think there at home? Is it number one? Or is it number two? Or is it number three? We pay $50 for each wrong vote. We pay $500 to the group if nobody can find the real Dushkov Popov. And Kitty starts, please.
Oh, it's very difficult. They could all be marvelous spies. I kind of went for number one. He's got a shifty look.
All right, we got to vote for number one. And number two, sir, what is your real name, please?
Hey, wait a minute. Whoa, hold it there. Wait a minute. Wait just a minute. Wait just
I'm
a way second
there. I'm way ahead of myself. Kitty, I'll get back to why I got off later, but Bill?
Well, now, I've studied spies since old days of World War I. Bill Boyd and his flying aces, and I got a good question. I voted happily for number three is the fellow I voted for.
There's nothing on
you voted for?
Huh?
It's blank.
You got blank on there.
Crazy?
That's that crazy disappearing ink I got from years ago. Oh, I voted for three there.
Crazy Cullen. All right, so we got a three show. Let's go to Peggy.
He hooks me in every time. Okay, now, number one, the money doesn't come out of the shoe. The cards come out of the shoe. And number three, Five Fingers was played by James Mason. He was a famous spy in Constantinople or Lisbon, one of those places. I voted for two because number nine is the highest number you can get.
I said it was a good team. Everybody's got one vote.
Ladies and gentlemen, Garry Moore.
Thank you. Hello, Bill Wendell. Hi, friends. Thanks for coming. You know, there is no spy in the whole world of literature who is more famous than James Bond. And it may surprise a lot of you to know that there is a spy in real life, a real spy, who was the prototype for James Bond. We have that super spy with us, and we will meet him and learn about him as soon as we meet our super panel here on To Tell the Truth.
Bill Cullen. Peggy Katz. Alan Alda. Carlisle.
D. Do you are you folks like me? Are you a sucker for James Bond?
Oh,
oh
do I love
yes.
that
and
stuff.
And all that? Oh, boy, I eat that up. And as I told the audience, there was a real-life one. There is a real-life one. Let's meet the real-life James Bond.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Dushko Popov.
Number two.
My name is Dushko Popov.
Number three.
My name is Dushko Popov.
And here is the spy story of Dushko Popov. It says, I, Dushko Popov, served as a spy during World War II.
Are you now?
Yes, sir.
That's the craziest way to retire I ever heard of in my life.
All right, from Bill Cullen, we go to Peggy.
Number three, in the Chemin de Fer game, were you going against the bank or were you holding the bank?
No, I was going against the bank.
Thank you. Number one, what's a shoe that in Chemin de Fer?
That is that little gadget where the money is coming in.
Thank you. Number two, what's the highest number to win with in Chemin de Fer?
Nine.
Thank you. Number three, where was Five Fingers stationed?
Where was what?
Five Fingers. He was a spy. You were tricycle. We had Five Fingers, too, on the other side.
No, you didn't.
Oh, we did, too. It was in a movie. Couldn't it? I saw that movie. Number two, how did you freely move from occupied, from Germany, for instance, off to occupied France to England? What kind of a passport did you use during the war?
I was stationed in England and worked in Lisbon.
Oh, you worked in Lisbon?
Where I could meet both parties.
Oh, how nice for you. Number one, do you put pepper in your vodka?
No, I didn't.
Well, number three, did you? Because James Bond did.
I drank whiskey, mainly.
Oh, yes, it's much more fashionable.
That's how James Bond lost the training wheels on his tricycle. Let's go down on Alda, please.
Boy, this is terrific. I think they're all good spies. Number one, why don't you want to talk about... I mean, you don't have to say who gave you the money, but why don't you want to talk about who gave you the money?
It's embarrassing. It was German money, actually.
I see. But wasn't your job, number one, wasn't your job to get money from them and lie to them and...
Yes, I did.
Yeah. Okay, number two, who paid for your trip to Washington when you went?
Who's not an American.
Ah, and number three, what did you do at the Casino Royale that attracted Ian Fleming's attention?
I played $50,000 on a Schmann Ferti.
Of your own money?
No, it was intelligent.
What were you doing it for?
I don't know, just for a...
For fun?
For the mood.
Uh-huh. Number two, do you know who Sir William Wiseman was?
No, I don't.
Do you know number one?
No, I'm sorry.
Number three, why did you have such a poor title, like tricycle?
Probably because I was a very poor chap.
Number two, was there another reason?
Well, tricycle is a triumvirate of three people who are in my sub-network.
What?
In my sub-network.
Uh-huh. In his sub-network.
Oh, I see.
All righty, and that takes us down to Bill Cullen.
Number one, did you also play $50,000 on Chemin de Fer?
Yes.
Was it your money, number one?
No.
Did you win?
It wasn't the point. It was just the point of putting it down to bluff somebody.
And whose money was it, number one? I was curious about that because
I don't want to talk about this even now. Not mine.
That's been...
Actually, it was the Germans paid for it, like everything else.
I'm going to say, like, interest on that alone, since you used it, would be worth a fortune. Number two is, did you spies during your time... I guess it's all right to call you a spy, because you said that yourself.
Sure.
Did you have that romantic thing with the ladies, always beautiful girls everywhere you went, and great stuff like that there, number two?
Sure.
Yeah?
Sure.
You did, huh? Number two, are
suddenly
you...
we got a whole new spot going here. Go.
Well, were you a married man, number two, when you were spying around?
No, I was not.
Are you married now?
Yes.
You're out of the game now, huh? Of
yes.
The spy racket, I mean.
Right.
Number one, when you were spying around and hobnobbing with those beautiful ladies, were you a married man?
No, sir.
In my book, which is called Spy Counter Spy, I tell how I acted as a double agent, passing misinformation to the Nazis while gathering accurate facts to give to British intelligence. Since Germany was paying the bills, I lived an elegant and luxurious life in those dangerous years, traveling back and forth between England and the continent. I even made a trip to the U.S., where I gave evidence to J. Edgar Hoover on the soon-to-occur Pearl Harbor bombing, but my warning was ignored. I participated in some of the most elaborate counter-espionage schemes of the war. Three of those years were later turned into movies. In addition, one evening at a gambling casino, my actions at the chemin de fer tables were utilized by Ian Fleming in his James Bond mystery, Casino Royale. However, I was not known as Secret Agent 007. My real code name was much less romantic. British intelligence called me Tricycle. Signed, Dushko Popov. And we can't start the questioning quite yet because my magic electronic decoder watch tells me it's time for, let me see, Mickey's big hand is on the 12, and yeah, it's time for a commercial. We'll be right back. Now, as I'm quite certain you recall, all three of the gentlemen sitting across the way claim to be Dushko Popov, who claims to be the prototype for super spy James Bond. And Kitty Carlisle, you said you dug James Bond, so
yes,
we'll start with
thank
you.
Thank you. Number two, why didn't Mr. Hoover believe you when you tried to announce the advent of Pearl Harbor?
Mr. Hoover did not believe me.
Why didn't he?
Because he did not trust anybody.